The second lecture in the series, we will be covering the comparative features of different machines as well as introduction to energy conversion principles. And we will also quickly go through the some of the constructional features in pictures, so that you will have some better idea of how they look like in real industrial practice. To recap, last lecture we discussed about historical developments, we discussed about parts of machines, we discussed about terminology and definitions, and we started with introduction to conventional machines. So these were the aspects which were covered in the earlier lecture. So from then onwards, we will try to look at the comparative features of conventional machines. Now, three machines which we are concentrating, let us see how do they compare. So the stator, the three machines, how the stator looks like. In a DC machine, stator is a salient pole field system. That means protruding poles with concentric coils wound on the poles, right? So that is the system in a DC machine. While a synchronous machine, you have three phase distributed winding, which is also the armature. So they are distributed windings, uniform distributed. It is typically a cylindrical surface except for slotting. So that is what you find in synchronous machine. Induction machine also same as synchronous machine. So the stator wise, synchronous machine, induction machine looks same, but DC machine is different. Okay. Now let us go to the next point of how the rotor looks like in the case of the three machines. Okay. Let us say this is the DC machine, this is the synchronous machine, and this is the induction machine. The rotor, the DC machine rotor is a distributed winding here, which is the armature. They are connected to the commutator. So ends of each of the commutator armature windings are connected to a pair of commutator segments, and you find that conductors of the armature, the commutator segments, they all rotate. So you find conductors rotate, commutator segments rotate, and the armature rotates, and the brushes are stationary. So this is the feature of the rotor of a DC machine. Conductors rotate, then commutator segments rotate, brushes are stationary, which affect the frequency conversion. On the other hand, let us look at the synchronous machine. Synchronous machine typically contains the field system. So synchronous machine rotor is a field. So what is that field? Field is the one which produces flux. That is, which comprise of two types. One is, it can either have salient poles, again they are excited through slip rings, or it can have cylindrical rotor with distributed windings. We saw the schematic in the last lecture, and they are all housed in slots. In salient pole machines, the windings are not housed in slots. In cylindrical machine, windings are housed in slots, but it is not uniformly distributed slots in cylindrical machines, because you have to provide some space for the poles, north pole, south pole. Let us look at induction machine. In induction machine, rotor is entirely different than a synchronous machine rotor, although the stator is identical. So you have maximum number of rotors are what are known as squirrel cage rotors. Squirrel cage rotor, we understood, are core having bars embedded in slots and shorted by end rings. So they have bars and rings. Bars are shorted on both sides by end rings, and this is one type which is mostly used from very small kilowatts up to few hundred kilowatt. But slip ring rotors or slip ring machines are also used for special applications, where you have this, the rotor is having a wound rotor with slip rings, whereas squirrel cage is not wound, they are just bars driven into the slots, whereas in slip ring machines they are typically three phase wound similar to stator, but three phase wound means six terminals brought out and they are connected in such a way to connect it to slip rings. Slip rings can be three slip rings or four slip rings or six slip rings, and they are distributed windings connected to the slip rings, and slip rings means connected to external brushes so that externally you can short circuit them and so on. So we have seen the rotor structure of three are entirely of a different nature. Okay. Now let us look at the type of supply to the stator. Whatever supply that you give to the stator. So in a DC machine, you give the supply to the stator. Sorry, this is stator. Is in a DC machine, it is the DC supply given to the field windings. Okay, this is what you give supply to the stator. Whereas supply to the stator in a synchronous machine would be three phase AC supply at fixed frequency. So here, supply to the stator is three phase AC at fixed frequency. And whereas in the case of induction machine, the stator supply is also three phase AC at fixed frequency. So you will notice that the supply system for synchronous and induction machines are identical, whereas for the DC machine it is a DC supply. Okay. Now let us look at the other features of the three machines. These are as follows. What is the rotor supply? What is it that you supply to the rotor of the three machines? In DC machine, you are supplying DC, but not directly. You are supplying it through the brushes. So through the brushes you supply DC or take out DC, whereas the armature winding itself will have AC in them. Whereas synchronous machine, what are you supplying to the rotor? Synchronous machine, you supply a DC because you have to produce a field. But how do you supply? Supply through the slip rings and brushes. Here also, rotor supply is always through the brushes. But here is brushes which connected to commutator, here brushes which connected to slip rings. Now induction machines, generally no external supply. Squirrel cage machine, you cannot give any supply at all because there are no access to the rotor, it is a brushless. But slip ring machines, you can provide an access to the rotor. Often it is some external supply can be given, which can be frequently dependent on speed. So the EMFs are induced in the rotor, and currents are in the rotor of induction, currents are typically induced, not injected. Okay. That is the difference that you will find, no injected currents, okay, except in slip ring machines. Okay. Now, where are these machines used? Major operations. We have said DC machines are mostly used as motors for variable speed applications in several cases. Today, for variable speed, you widely use DC motors. You use them in electric traction, use them in mining, use them in steel plants, you use them in several places, textile mills, paper mills, you use them as motors. So you do not use them often as generators. But it is not true with synchronous machines. Synchronous machine is mostly used as a generator for bulk power generation. Most of the power generated in the world are through synchronous generators driven by prime movers like turbines. While the induction machine is mostly used as a motor, so bulk of the workhorse is used as a workhorse in most of the industries. So this is the induction machine. Okay. So in majority of electric, that means wherever you find typically nearly constant speed drives, use induction motor. Use them in pumps, blowers, compressors, fans. You use them in all over. We use them in power plants, petrochemicals. Use them in the process industries and so on. Okay. Now this is a major type of operation. Minor type of operation, they are used also as generators, what often to supply to the motor or for welding applications or electroplating or battery charging. So some application DC motors are also used for generator operation. Okay. Whereas synchronous machines are also used as motors, like cement mill drives and constant speed, low speed drives and so on. So they are also, and they are also used as synchronous condensers, where you can control the power factor of the motor, which in turn control the power factor of the supply system. Okay. Induction machines are also used as induction generators for power generation in small hydro, wind electric systems, and isolated as well as grid connected generators, induction generators are used. So you find some similarities and differences between the three conventional machines. Okay. Now before we go into detail of how they work, what are the basic principles involved, we can quickly look at some of the pictures. You find here the stampings of a state of the different machines. For example, this is the stamping of a stator of an induction machine. You see this stamping will make will go to make the stator, and these number of slots you will see here, this is the slot and this is the tooth, and ultimately these are the slotings are to make to fix it to the frame, right. And this will be multiple of 3 because this is 3 phase windings. So this will be 3 phase and according to number of poles. Okay. Whereas we see here a stamping of a rotor of an induction machine. Now this one will be the one which go to the shaft and the key, and this also where you can put the bars. And you will notice that these are all closed, this is the open slots. So that means you drive bars here in these, this is the squirrel cage rotor. So bars are put here, and are often you put aluminum liquid into it so that it is die cast as a aluminum. So you may see typically you may find a stator and the rotor goes inside, and they are machined in such a way that there is a small air gap between the two. So you have the stator stamping, rotor stamping, the shaft. The stator will be fixed to the frame, inside the rotor is the shaft. Okay. So this is you will have an idea of the stampings of an induction machine. Of course, we have another rotor stamping of induction machines, and these are the slots which can have 2 conductors, one small conductor, one big conductor. These are called double rotor. So you have 2 rotors are there. Okay. And of course, you have a rotor stamping of a very small motor, you know, typically for single phase motors, etc. This is also for squirrel cage. So you find this is the size of a very small motor which can be used. This is another stamping of rotor of an induction machine, and this is again another stamping of the rotor of induction machine. Okay. Now this yesterday we said the small photograph of different types of stampings, their punchings. You will see there from where different types of machines are made, and you will see small holes here. these are called ventilating ducts for cooling the motors. There are ducts here in these stampings which are used. Okay. These are the this is the photograph of the coils. You see the coils, they are basically bars, thick bars of large motors, and these coils go into the slots. Okay. And this is the these are wire wound. This you find compared to this, what you have here. Here you have larger number of turns, here you have smaller number of turns, thicker wires, larger number of turns, thinner wires. So again, these are all housed in slots. Okay. This is the photograph of a frame. Okay. So the frame looks like this, and this is the terminal box, and you find they are all protruded, the surface. The reason for that is you want to increase the cooling area. You want to increase the area of cooling, so it improves the cooling system for this, and that is how some of the frames have this type of protrusions. Okay. Okay, we go. This is photograph taken inside a factory where they are making the commutators. So you see the commutators are being machined. These are the commutator segments. This is just a commutator assembly. There are several commutator segments are there, which goes and fixed to the armature. Okay. This is the field the stator of a DC machine. So you find these are the main poles, these are the poles. How many poles are there here? 4 poles. So this is 1, 2, 3, 4, and in between the two poles there is also small poles, and these are called interpoles. Right. These are used for improving the commutation process. So these are the 4 poles and the 4 interpoles. They are wound. You will see on the poles there is the winding. Okay. And this is the bare pole, which is yet to be fixed to the frame. Right. This is not wound. Okay. This is laminated. These are poles, and they are just to be fixed. These are again the poles which are already fixed, so you will find a frame, the wound poles and so on. Okay. Here you see a picture of different parts of a 3-phase induction machine. That means it is opened up. So you find here the bearings here, this is end plates, this is the frame, this is the rotor. The squirrel cage rotor here, again another end plate, and this is the end cover, and this is the terminal box. Okay. Similarly, you find the stator of a large AC machine. This can be both synchronous or induction. So you find here the conductors or the windings, and they are being pushed inside. This winding is presently being pushed inside. They are inside the frame. So there are several. You find the slots here, and the conductors are the windings placed inside the slots. Okay. Here again is the rotor of a synchronous machine. That means you find the protruded poles. You see the large poles are there, and on which the windings are there. Okay. This is how a rotor is made. This is called a die cast system. Die cast means you are pouring aluminium liquid. This is again a picture taken inside a factory, and a die cast rotor is made. You will see aluminium liquid being poured, and it is subsequently being taken out. Okay. Of course, this again an unwound stator of an induction machine. This is the rotor of an induction machine. The squirrel cage rotor is the bars are being made, and you find the end rings. Of course, these are the fans. So you have I mean, you can see the size. These are large induction motors being made. Again, the similar pictures. Because here again is an unwound stator, unwound rotor of an induction machine. I mean, you can just see the size of the machines being used. This is a brush and commutator and brush assembly, again at the end of a DC machine. So this is a total induction machine which is made, and you see the top structure is basically for cooling purpose. You see, find there are lot of tubes, and there are this cooling system, because you have to dissipate the heat. And here you see a picture on the how the shaft is being driven inside a machine. See, this is the shaft, and this goes inside the machine of a squirrel cage machine. So this is a fully wound stator of a three-phase machine, and here you find the rotor of a induction machine. This is unwound and this is wound. And this is how a total induction machine looks like. It is a large machine with all the terminals and all these parts. This is the complete picture of a cut view of a DC machine. You have the commutator, the brush, the parts of the field and the armature and the terminal box and so on. Here is again a part of a large synchronous machine. These are all cooling arrangements which are used. It is a 3600 RPM, that is a two pole machine, a conductor cooled generator, and the conductor is cooled by water. You find here is the field structure of the rotor, and this is the stator. And this is a cut view of a synchronous machine. And here, this is a large hydro generator. Again, you see the stators partly wound, which is there under construction in a factory. It will go into a hydro system. So these are how it looks like a hydro generator. You will see the size. It is basically to sensitize on the size. And here is the hydroelectric power plant inside view of one of the power station. This is the hydro. There are different generators are being placed. They are vertical shaft generators. Similarly, you will see the inside of hydro generator being made. And that means the hydro generator is so large you cannot take it completely from the factory. You may have to take in parts and assemble in the site. That is how it is done. Again, you will see the windings, the armature windings of their sizes like this. You will see this is only segment of the armature. This is not full. This is only segment of the three phase armature which is built. And you will see here, this is the size of the stator of a hydro generator. In fact, it is said that the largest hydro generator you can have a symphony orchestras can sit inside. So these are the rotor or the, you can have several number of poles. You will see the count the number of poles, there may be in maybe sometime 30-40 more number of poles are there. So this is the rotor assembly, completely assembled rotor. So these are basically the pictures of hydro generators which are used. Let us see, again inside part of a AC machine, the stator design. and this is again the other part of the stator. So you can see from manufacturer's catalogs like this several portions. I mean, you can see here, this will be interesting. This is the rotor of a cylindrical rotor synchronous machine. This is cylindrical rotor synchronous machine. You see, this is the pole area and this is the conductor area. Okay, so this is all you find the windings like this. Okay, let us see if you have any other clearer picture. Okay, I think we have seen enough of these pictures, and this is the traction motor completely made. So the whole idea of showing these pictures today was that these motors can be of a very small size to very large size, handling a few watts to few megawatts. So largest synchronous generators may be around 1000 megawatts, and the induction motors are also maybe 10, 20, 30 megawatts. So it will all the design would depend upon the power handling capacities, and so it will have a complication in making them. So you must understand, it is not only electrical aspects but also mechanical aspects and control aspect, thermal aspect, all these things will become important in the making of such machines. Now we will switch to the energy conversion principles. What are the principles behind which energy conversion takes place in all these rotating electrical machines? These are the basically it will have two things, two factors are important. One is there will be voltage induced in the coil. You will find in the coil, whatever we have seen, armature coils, voltages are induced. Okay, then torque is developed on the shaft. So these two things happens in all machines. These voltages are induced in the coil and torque is developed on the shaft. Okay. Now therefore how does it happen? So you would like to know what is the basic principle in which they happens. It happens, voltage is induced due to change of flux linkage. That is the basic principle. Any coil which undergoes change of flux linkage, so there is a change of flux linkage which causes a voltage induced in the coil. Now how is the torque developed? The basic principle of torque developed is what we call it as a virtual work, where if there is a change of magnetic energy with position, whenever the magnetic energy changes with position, the torque is experienced by the shaft. So if the magnetic energy is not changing with position, no torque is developed. Okay. So it is the d lambda by dt here, and here it is dw field by d theta. These are the main thing. So there is a change of stored energy with theta, and there is a change of flux linkage. So you noticed on both of the things, what are we concerned? You are concerned with flux linkage, you are concerned with stored magnetic field energy, isn't it? So we should know what is the magnetic field energy, what is the flux linkage, then you will have a process in which you can understand what is the voltage, what is the torque. So we boiled this concept, therefore, so we have to understand voltage and torque development, we need to know what is the magnetic field that has to be developed. So we need importantly the knowledge of magnetic field pattern in the machine is important. So, we should know what is the nature of magnetic field inside the machine. You know, all of them are electromagnetic structures. So, we should know a knowledge of magnetic field pattern in the machine is important. Now, the core has high permeability compared to air gap. Permeability, this is another fact. Therefore, in the core there is negligible magnetic field intensity. So, H inside the core is 0 or very negligible, you neglect it, right. Now, where is the magnetic energy then stored? Therefore, energy is stored. So, energy stored in the core is negligible compared to air gap. So, this is next postulates we have. So, we want to know the energy, magnetic field energy inside the structure, but we know that very negligible magnetic field energy is in the core because of very high permeability and low H or low magnetic field intensity. Therefore, we come to this conclusion that the most of the magnetic field is energy is stored in the air gap. So, thus the nature of magnetic field in the air gap, this is what you are concerned about, is very important, right. So, first of all we should know what is the nature of magnetic field in the air gap of all these machines, DC machine, synchronous machine, induction machine. And we know these magnetic fields are created by current carrying conductors or permanent magnets. Okay. So, we should know the nature of magnetic fields in these machines. So, next is let us understand what are the air gap magnetic fields, right. So, we would like to next question is we should understand what is the air gap magnetic fields. That is magnetic fields in the air gap. Okay. Now, air gap magnetic field is this, what is it decided by? Air gap magnetic field is decided by the potential of stator and rotor surface, right. So, you have a stator surface and let us say you have a rotor surface. So, this is the stator surface and this is the rotor surface. Right. Now, how is the magnetic field produced? I would like to know what is the magnetic potential here and what is the magnetic potential here. Okay. So, usually we can assume that the flux lines are radial everywhere. So, let us assume for the moment in the air gap flux lines are all radial. Either they leave the stator surface and enter the rotor surface or leave the rotor surface or enter the stator surface. So, either it can go from this to this or this to or it can come. So, if you make one path flux path like this, you will see some portions it leaves this rotor surface goes to stator surface and somewhere it comes from stator surface goes into the stator surface. So, there will be after all flux lines you are aware are closed lines, right. When they close inside the, so the flux path will be passing through the rotor core, air gap, then the stator core and come back. And we know that H inside here is 0 or H inside here is 0. So, we are concerned how will this be in the air gap. Now, how much flux will flow from stator to rotor will depend upon the potential of the stator surface and rotor surface, magnetic potential. So, let us say this potential here is let us say F of the stator and here it is F of the rotor. You are aware magnetic potential are MMF, right. So, stator is has a potential Fs and rotor is have a potential Fr and that can be positive or negative. So there is certain quantum of potential at the stator surface, quantum of potential at rotor surface, and that difference between the two is the potential difference across the air gap. So F of the air gap will be that of Fs minus Fr. What is that? Is the potential difference, and that potential difference will cause the flux. The magnetic potential difference will cause the flux. And how will these potentials occur in the first place? Magnetic potential occur because of current carrying conductors located in those members. If I put a current carrying conductor in stator, it suddenly makes the potential to become non-zero at the stator surface. If I put a conductor, current carrying conductor in the rotor, it makes the potential become non-zero in the rotor surface. If I do not put any conductor with current in the rotor, means the rotor surface is dead. It is like a simple iron cylinder. It dead means no magnetic potential. Again, the stator also, if you do not pass a current in the conductor, stator surface is dead. That means no magnetic potential in the stator surface, right. So you can, we would like to know what is the magnetic potential in the stator surface and what is the magnetic potential in the rotor surface, right. So our next question is, for different type of excitation, what is the nature of magnetic potential or MMF in the respective surfaces, okay. So we have to take one at a time in doing this, okay. So the in understanding this magnetic field, we have to look at the potential of stator surface and rotor surface. Now we have seen that air gap MMF, the MMF across the air gap, is therefore the difference between the stator MMF, let us say Fs, and the rotor MMF Fr. So we have seen F of the air gap is the difference between Fs and Fr. So F air gap is Fs minus Fr, okay, in the radial direction, because we have always assumed that it is all flux lines are radial, right. Therefore, we are only concerned in the radial direction, what is the flux and MMF pattern. Now the next thing is, we know the stator currents cause stator MMF. This is next postulate, okay, and the rotor currents cause rotor MMF. So this is a simple statement. When the rotor conductors carry current, it causes the rotor MMF. When the stator current, when the stator currents are there, they cause stator MMF, okay. Now what, now our task therefore is, our task is to determine the nature of MMF due to these currents, right. So we have to find out, if I have a current carrying conductor, how it will produce an MMF, okay. So we should start a very simple case. So let us take a concentrated winding like this. So we will case 1, we will have a concentrated winding and it looks like this. So I have taken a stator with only one winding, concentrated one coil with n turn. It is having a, it is a n turn coil. So it current goes into the bottom A and A dash, and distance between them is 180 electrical degrees, okay. So I put one here, one conductor, one conductor. So you have a coil, so it enters through this and comes out through this. So let us say this is A and this is A dash, okay. Rotor is dead, no conductors, no currents, okay. And you have, this is the air gap G, okay. So you will notice, whenever a current is passing through this, the flux lines will go like this, and on this side the flux lines will go opposite direction. So if I put a A and let us say X and A dash. Now, what do you notice in this portion? In this portion, flux lines are all leaving the stator surface. They are leaving the stator, entering the rotor surface. That is A, X, A dash. It is leaving stator surface. Means here, what do you expect Fs to be? Positive, isn't it? Because rotor is zero potential. So if we let us say rotor surface is Fr is zero. Rotor, because since rotor doesn't carry any current, okay. Now you find this is positive potential. Whereas here, this is Fs is positive. Look at the other direction. That means A dash Ya. What do you notice here in this portion? What flux is leaving the rotor surface and entering the stator surface. That means rotor surface must be a higher potential than the stator surface, and rotor surface being a zero potential, what will be stator potential will be? It will be negative. So here Fs is negative. So we come to this postulate that one portion it is positive potential Fs, other portion negative potential, and since there is no conductors, it you expect by symmetry they must all be same. So you find a picture like this. You have positive potential between one portion, okay, AX A dash, and AY A dash you have negative potential. A is here. So you have, if you go back here, AX A dash, it is positive. So you have a positive potential and here it is a negative potential. So if you plot MMF distribution over space theta, you will find that the MMF will be rectangular like this. And what will be the magnitude of MMF? We are interested to know how much will be the MMF, okay. We know they are fixed. So from here to here positive MMF, here to here is negative MMF. So to obtain that, we know that if you close H dot dl is current enclosed. So you take, let us say this is the contour, you just take it round like this. How much is current is enclosed? It has n turns and carrying a current I, current enclosing n I. It encloses the current and there is no H in the air, there is no H in the core, so all H is in the air, so there is a HG here and HG here, right, there is a H into G here, H into G here, so therefore if you call this is H1, this is H2, you will say H1G plus H2G is equal to Ni, right, where H1, H2 are the air gap magnetic field intensity in this portion. Let us say this is H1 and let us say this is H2. I put this because here H is 0, right. So you find this like this. Now H1G plus H2G is equal to Ni, where G is the gap length, right. And we also know B dot ds is 0. That means whatever flux, we know the whatever flux that enters here to the rotor will have to come out. See, from here to here, whatever flux which enters in this portion will have to come out of this portion, okay. Now what is the flux that comes enters the rotor? That means flux entering the rotor, the flux entering the rotor over a pole must be same as flux leaving the stator over the other pole, sorry, okay. So from stator it goes to rotor and rotor it comes to stator, right. So it has to, that means whatever the flux leaves from here, it should enter the other side, okay. Now these two postulates will bring you the situation. What is the flux entering is if B1 into pi dl by 2, that is the pole area, where D is the mean dyad the air gap and L is the axial length of the core, and other side is B2 into pi dl by 2, right. Because both sides you have whatever is the flux, this is the air gap diameter. So this you have this situation, and by symmetry what do you say, B1 equal to B2. So whatever is the flux density here is the same as the flux density here, B1 equal to B2, H1 equal to H2, and we have the relation H1 plus H2 into G equal to Ni, which we have taken as the first statement which we made, that is this H1G plus H2G equal to Ni, or H1 plus H2G equal to Ni, H1 equal to H2. So what is H1 equal to H2 equal to Ni by 2G. So we got come to this conclusion that the magnetic field intensity in the air gap due to a single conductor will be given by Ni by 2G. And what is the MMF between the two? MMF would be, MMF drop is the drop across the air gap. When you know H, the MMF in the air gap, F will be Hg. So Ni by 2, right? So this is the MMF. So air gap MMF, which is Fs, is H1g is equal to Ni by 2. So that is Ni by 2 between 0 to pi, and minus Ni by 2 from pi to 2 pi. Because you know one side it is positive, other side it is negative. So it is a rectangular wave. This will be the position, Ni by 2. This will be the MMF waveform of this. So you find as a simple case that it is a rectangular wave. MMF wave is a rectangular wave varying in space, not in time. It goes on varying in space. If somebody walks through the, you know, over the surface of the stator, one will see a positive H from AX A' and negative from A' Y A'. So you find one portion positive, other portion negative, like this. Okay. So this is one thing we observe. It is the rectangular wave, and any rectangular wave you can have the fundamental, because we, right. What is its fundamental of a rectangular wave? That means it will have a fundamental F1 sin theta. Okay. What is that F1? F1 is by Fourier series, you know, this is the F1 is the peak of the fundamental given by 4 by pi Ni by 2, because Ni by 2 is the amplitude of the rectangular wave. So the its fundamental will be 4 by pi Ni by 2. And this is a two pole system. So we have now seen in a two pole system we can get the fundamental, let me see, which is, sorry, okay. So you find ultimately you have a rectangular wave, and this is the fundamental, and its this value is 4 by pi Ni by 2. This is the fundamental of the MMF. Okay. So we stop here, understanding that with a single coil we get a rectangular wave with a fundamental whose fundamental can be obtained, and this will be the beginning. So let us next class we will look at what happens if you have more number of coils are displaced in different slots. Okay, we'll stop this lecture today.